Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony. And thanks for the humorous photos on social media.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Members, my name is Eric Stolhansky. I'm an actor, filmmaker, and current chair of the Minnesota Film and Television Board. It's very much an honor to be here today. Thank you very much. I'm here to testify because the Snowbate program that we've been running for the last 3 years has been just a tremendous asset to jobs and for money that's been coming in the state of Minnesota since 2013. We've created 3,000 jobs and $50 million of private spending to the state, and it would be an absolute shame to repeal Snowbate. It's been just a terrific jobs creation program, and it's brought in great revenue to the state. And personally, I moved back here to make films, proud of being from Minnesota, proud to live in Minnesota. My wife and I both live here, and we want to make movies and television shows here in Minnesota. But without tax incentives, I'll be forced to have to go somewhere else. And I'd love to make movies and television shows here. So I hope you'll please consider that. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Mr. Chair and members of the committee, thank you for having me. My name is Brian Simpson. I'm not paid to be here, but I am the business agent for IATSE, which is IATSE. It's the International Alliance of Theatrical Stage Employees, Local 490. I'm also a crew member, and I work in this industry on a daily basis. So what I want to do real quick is just, you know, there's going to be some other speakers other than me speaking about, obviously, the Snowbate Jobs Program bill, which is not included in the House omnibus bill here. And they're all, you know, these speakers are going to tell you about the increase in production we've had over the last 3 years, the economic impact, also the jobs creation. And that's all real, and but, you know, a lot of you, you're going to hear about that from other people. So what I want to talk to you about is one of the most popular critiques of the film industry and the Snowbate program in Minnesota is this idea that it only creates short-term employment or temp jobs. And, you know, that's what, you know, a lot of our critics like to say, that because a film has a beginning and an end, that means it is a temp job and that is it. But this is a project-based industry. It's very similar to the construction trades. You know, when someone finishes building a house, they don't just cash it in, they build another house. And that's the same way that the film industry works. When we finish a film, then crew members move on to the next one. If they were working in TV commercials, well, you know, 1 week it might be, you know, they're working for Best Buy, and then the next week is Target, the next week could be for a political spot, you know, a politician. You know, it doesn't really matter what the product is. What matters is that, you know, people who do this industry string together projects. They start projects, finish projects over and over again for the course of a career. A lot of the members in Local 490, which covers the state of Minnesota, film and TV workers. We've got members who've been doing this for over 30 years continuously. You know, so, and the thing to remember too is I think that there's this idea that because a film begins and ends, and maybe people have day jobs, and that's not true at all. This is like what we do for work. This is the day job. There's no, you know, taking a break to go do a film. This is what people do. You know, and the other thing that I want to tell you about is that these same crew members are the ones that are training the next generation of Minnesotans to do this industry. And up until recently, you know, 3 years ago, before we had the Snowbate program, you know, young students or maybe people with no college at all would ask, you know, how do I get started in the film industry in Minnesota? And I would tell every one of them, you have to move to another state, that this is not a place that is open to business for that kind of an industry. But now, in the last 3 years, I mean, things have changed a lot. You know, three years ago, people could say this industry was just a niche industry in the Twin Cities. And, you know, maybe they would have been right, you know, actually. But now, I mean, we have a producer who's investing money in opening a soundstage on the Iron Range, you know, in Chisholm, because people want to shoot movies in northern Minnesota. We have, you know, a production company that's done two seasons of a series for ABC. We have, you know, people bringing TV commercials here from California that are coming here because of the incentive. This stuff is all real, and this was not here 3 years ago. It absolutely was not, and it will not be again if this program either shrinks or goes away. And You know, so right now, we have the chance to you know, when someone asks, how do I get started in this film industry, the question is not, like, what state should you move to? It's, what is it that you actually want to do in this industry? Do you want to work in camera, or would you like to work with wardrobe? Do you want to drive a truck? There's all kinds of things that people can do. When this goes away, you know, if you lessen this program in your bill, then what happens is we say, you know, maybe it's time to go to Georgia. To a state that offers a more welcome business climate. You know, any business owner, whether it's this industry or any other industry, is going to look at a state and say, is that a place that welcomes my business? And if Minnesota's not, then really what is the point of bringing a business here? So, you know, I'll try to, you know, keep it brief. Thanks for letting me jump up a little bit, but I just hope that you reconsider your decision, and I'll take any questions you might have.
Well, thank you very much, both mm-hmm. of you, for your testimony. We appreciate mm-hmm. it, and thanks for sticking around. We had the floor session, and we had the caucus. Mm-hmm. So thanks again. For any other questions from members? Representative Metza.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just a comment. You mentioned the shop up in Chisholm, and it's great to see him coming in. And I can give an example from my district. There's a gentleman who went out to California, made his living for his life in production, now is trying to bring things back home, and we did a few little horror movies up there over the last year. And you know, one example I can think of that actually really shows what the benefit to the community is, we have a hotel in our town, and $30,000 in business over a month I'd imagine was a lot more than they would see in a downturn time, especially with the locals not, you know, staying there as much and stuff. So that business was much needed, and I think far outweighed the investment that the state made in getting it there. So just want to put that on the record.
Thank you, Representative Metza, and thank you again to our testifiers. We appreciate
Mr. Chair.
It.
Thank you.
Representative Fabian.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just curious, you know, you said, and I wrote this down, I want to make sure I have it correct, you said that Minnesota is not open for business. If it weren't for this program, what is it about the Minnesota business climate that makes it, I'll say, impossible for you folks to do your business here?
To either of the testifiers?
Mr. Chair, Representative Fabian. I can answer that. What the reason why is that other states offer this. A lot of states offer incentives for this kind of industry. So does most of the provinces of Canada, and they, on top of that, they also have, you know, the convenience of 75 cents on the dollar to go with that. So when you, if we don't have an incentive, then we can't really compete with any of the states that are offering that. It's not like Minnesota is the only one that's offering this. And actually, you know, just to for a point of information, the incentive that we do have, the Snowbate program, is actually incredibly small compared to what other states are offering. And that's one thing that maybe I should point out, is that over the course of the last 3 years, we're not you know, the key player in this industry by the amount of money that we're offering. But we're still, with an underfunded program, we're still finding ways to be successful and compete with other states. You know, the bill that was proposed asked for a $10 million asked for an additional $10 million for this program. That would not put us at the forefront of the industry, but that would keep us at the table to at least be somewhat competitive to try to bring productions here.
Thank you again both for your testimony. We greatly appreciate it.
Thank you.
Kara Ruff. Is Ruby Lee still here?
Yes.
Okay, you're on deck. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Mr. Chair, members, I'm Kara Ruff. I'm the executive director of the Center for Independent Living in Sauk Rapids, which serves central Minnesota region, and the vice president of MASIL, the Minnesota Association of Centers for Independent Living. We would very much like to thank you, Mr. Chair and members, for finding money in your bill to support Centers for Independent Living in Minnesota. People with disabilities comprise 18 to 20% of our population, making them the largest minority group. We are consumer-based, cross-disability, serving all disabilities, physical, cognitive, mental, emotional, chemical, and sensory. We're non-residential, consumer-controlled, and there are 8 Centers for Independent Living in Minnesota, meeting the needs of thousands of people with disabilities. We provide a wide range of services geared to assist those with all types of disabilities to live as independently as possible. These dollars will provide us with the support necessary to complete access projects such as ramps and home modifications, which keep people living in their homes, as well as much-needed community education, advocacy, and technology to better keep up and to serve the whole state, and much more. Your leadership and insight in providing these dollars not only helps people with disabilities across the state, but will save the taxpayers in the state money. Last year, Centers for Independent Living provided a return on investment of approximately $12 million by either relocating individuals or preventing the out-of-home placement. I can see, and I've been here most of the day, and you have very important issues before you, very complex and varied issues before you. On behalf of the Centers for Independent Living, we applaud your recognition of CILs and providing funding that provides for the most basic and fundamental of human rights, the right to live with dignity, choice, and as independently as possible. We thank you so much for your support.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Ruby Lee and then Commissioner Tingerthal.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the committee. Good evening. My name is Ruby Lee. I'm president of Comunidades Latinas Unidas en Servicio, Latino Communities United in Service. I just want to take a brief moment to thank Chair Garofalo and Representative Baker for their leadership and their trust in us and in the inclusion of our proposal in the bill. Our proposal focuses on expanding services and proven workforce training models that lead to higher wages for the communities that we serve. The funding will allow us to reach new geographic regions, especially Greater Minnesota. We look forward to delivering new services and coming back to you in 18 months to show successful results and demonstrating that you made a wise investment in our communities. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Commissioner, please accept my apologies. My intent was to have you and the other commissioners testify before the recess, but we were literally told to recess our committee. Not saying I agree with that decision, but sometimes you gotta do what you're told. So, Commissioner, thanks for your patience. Apologize for keeping you around, but please proceed with your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and members of the committee. The pages are passing out a handout that I'll refer to briefly. As I travel around the state, I meet with a lot of community leaders, and I continue to hear that workforce housing is a significant need both in the metro area and Greater Minnesota. Housing vacancy rates are at historic low levels, and employers everywhere are seeking workers for their businesses, and oftentimes they cite the fact that there's no place to live or no place for teachers or cops to live in the community. And with that in mind, we were certainly very surprised and very concerned about this bill's proposed $5 million cut to the long-established challenge program. As many of you know, we award challenge dollars every year through our competitive request for proposal process. And it often takes a couple of years for housing development projects to come together by the time developers find a site and arrange other financing. And frankly, given the fact that these dollars were allocated by last year's session, many communities are already developing proposals to be submitted this year. Our base budget for challenge is $12.9 million per year, which we distribute both for multifamily and for single family developments in many communities. In 2015, we used part of the appropriation to fund four workforce housing developments, including communities in Perham, Worthington, St. Michael, and Rochester. This was on top of projects that we funded in 2013 and 14 in places like Thief River Falls, Roseau, Jackson, Owatonna, and Duluth. And you can see from the handout that we've just given you, on the back side of that handout is a list of the projects and the communities where they're located. These developments not only provide affordable workforce housing, but they have partnered with companies like Polaris, JBS, AGCO, the Mayo Clinic, and DigiKey. Last year, when we did have our full challenge appropriation, we received $17 million in requests for gap financing from the Challenge Program for workforce housing that we were unable to fund because we ran out of Challenge dollars. These included proposals for developments in Red Wing, Austin, Buffalo, Mankato, Crookston, and Albert Lea. And I will tell you that leaders in those communities are very much hoping that they will be funded in this year's competition. We also had almost $4 million in single family developments that we were unable to fund in both Greater Minnesota and the metro area for lack of dollars. This $5 million cut would drastically limit the tools that we have available to respond to communities' housing needs, whether they be multifamily or single family. And honestly, we will take the odds of receiving funds from about 1 in 4 to about 1 in 8. Our recent community dialogue, so we were just in Marshall last week, communities have expressed concerns that it's increasingly competitive to receive these challenge dollars, and these cuts will further exacerbate that problem. So we encourage the committee to reconsider those cuts, given our proven track record. We do want to thank the committee for supporting the two very small policy changes that are in Article 4 and the proposed Landlord Risk Mitigation Fund that is included in the budget. I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Commissioner. Representative Mahoney.
So let me get this straight. Just want to make sure I'm understanding. Your Minnesota Housing Finance Agency and the Challenge Grant did 648 units of housing in Greater Minnesota. That's just multi-family, multi-unit housing?
Commissioner?
The 648 includes single family.
Mr. Chair.
Representative Mahoney.
So under the new program that the Republicans are proposing in this bill, how many units of workforce housing do you think you'll be able to do in Greater Minnesota? Just a guess.
Commissioner.
Mr. Chair and Member Mahoney, this is 3 years, I would say maybe 150 as compared to maybe 300 that we could do without the cut.
Representative Mahoney.
So this bill is a 50% cut to Greater Minnesota housing. Is that a fair statement to make, Madam Commissioner?
Commissioner?
Mr. Chair, Member Mahoney, that's a rough estimate on my part without a calculator.
Well,
Mahoney.
I'm just, Mr. Chair, I'm just going to go on that. I'm going to take a rough estimate, but this is a rough estimate that the Republicans who ran on a Greater Minnesota agenda, and I think she just said Marshall got denied because they didn't have enough funds. So the Greater Minnesota is getting the shaft by the Republicans who promised to make this the Greater Minnesota session. Is there any media in this audience that could actually report this to Greater Minnesota that the Republicans have cut your housing fund by 50%? For your workers out in Greater Minnesota. They cut jobs, they cut housing. I'm wondering, when will people learn?
Is that a question or is that a statement, Representative Mahoney?
I think it's a statement of fact.
Thank you. Any other questions for the Commissioner? Thank you, Commissioner. I appreciate you sticking around.
Thank you.
Heidi Ann Schuster. Then Commissioner Thornton, are you still here? Okay, you're on deck.
Mr. Chairman and members, my name is Heidi Schuster. I'm the Director of Operations at Splice, and I'm also the Chairman of the Snowbate Committee. I'm here to talk about the proposal to unfund Minnesota and Film and TV Board and the Snowbate. film incentive. My business is post-production, editing, sound design, color correction, that sort of thing. And in the last 3 years, when there's been adequate funding of Snowbate, a lot of work has come to the state. We've done series work for Fox, for ABC, for History, and we worked on a feature this summer for Fox Searchlight. That's kind of business we haven't been able to get in the past, because without an incentive, they will not come here. It's a business decision. They will go to a state that has one. It's that simple. You know, that's how they make the decision about where they go. So if we want to keep this industry, and I think we do, then that's what we're going to need to do. 49 states have film boards or film commissions. And when someone wants to come to a state, they assume they have a film commission, they call them up, and the film commission will help them with logistical support, like permitting, tax, labor laws, insurance, locations, and a centralized production directory so that they can find crew to do whatever they're doing. And sometimes it's news stories, sometimes it's TV series, sometimes, you know, it's corporate video or advertising. But not having that core infrastructure, which is expected by people, will totally stop us in our tracks. And the incentive allows more work to come, because it is a decider for those companies of where they're going to go. And I know that a lot of our clients do get the incentive. We don't get it directly, but they've told me they really like working with us. But if that isn't something that the state offers, they will not be able to bring their work here. And I don't want that to happen, because I want to keep growing our industry and making it productive.
Thank you very much for your testimony. We appreciate it. Any questions from the committee? Thank you very much. Commissioner Thornton and Todd Bornhauser. Is Todd here? Yeah, he's coming down. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and continue with your...
Thank you very much. My name is David Thornton. I'm Assistant Commissioner at the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency. As you might guess, I'm here to talk about Article 13, Section 12 of the bill, which prohibits any agency from continuing efforts to develop a state plan in response to the EPA's Clean Power Plan in light of the Supreme Court stay. We oppose this section. We talked about it quite a bit last week, and Commissioner Rothman mentioned a number of the points that I was going to make today. The only other thing I would add is that it's a very complicated plan. We have to prudence suggest that we assume that EPA will win their court case, and that they might not give us as much time to work on a plan when it's all over, and we'd like to keep working with our stakeholders and do the best job we can for Minnesota. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Any questions from the committee? One question for me, just Commissioner, is it still the Dayton administration's belief that they can allocate the carbon allowances without statutory approval?
That was our belief last week, Mr. Chairman, and it's still our belief.
Thank you very much, Commissioner. We appreciate your testimony. Mr. Bornhauser, and then let's see, Mary Beth Romslow. Mary Beth, are you here? No? Okay. Jane Durkee? Jane's not here. Okay. John Anderson? Is John Anderson here? Okay. Kaiser Clark? Mr. Clark? Okay. Aswar Rahman? R-A-H-M-A-R? Okay. Rahman? I'm sorry, Aswar Rahman? Okay. Jim Geib? G-E-I-B is the last name?
I think you've scared a lot of people off, Mr. Chair.
I am nothing but not hot. Ryan Smith? You're on deck, Mr. Smith. So welcome to the committee, sir. Please state your name for the record.
My name is Todd Bornhauser. Chair Garofalo and committee members, thank you for letting me speak for a few minutes. My real job is the president of the Northfield Area Chamber of Commerce and Tourism, and I'm speaking tonight kind of out of frustration and dismay that the elimination of the funding for the Minnesota Film and TV Board and Snowbate program. We were very fortunate in Northfield this year to be chosen as a site for movie production. The Last Love Letter, which was filmed 3 weeks in January in Northfield. And those are 3 weeks that are dead in our community. And the dollars that were generated through that were in excess of $445,000 that was spent in Minnesota for that production. And we anticipate probably half of that was spent in Northfield. Someone asked about the difficulty of filming here. They originally came in December to film one of our festivals that we do that I haven't come and asked for state funding, by the way, for, and that's our winter walk. It was 45 degrees and rainy, probably the first time ever. So, and then back in January to film, start filming the movie, and you've got snow on the ground, so it makes it difficult from that standpoint. In addition, their first day of filming, it was 13 below zero when they started on Monday morning. The beauty of film is that you can say that you're filming in Northfield, Minnesota, but you can film many other places. And many of those places are much easier for them to work at, and the funding that they receive from other states that are interested in having that come to their communities and their state is much greater than what we get here. It was a great learning experience for me. I've never been involved in a filming process before. Working with the crew that was Minnesota-based, it was amazing to me how many jobs that are local, that come down from the cities, that do many projects throughout the year. This wasn't a, where they brought a plane full of people from outside of this state. There's actually an industry here, a cottage industry, that needs to be budded and developed, and this is one way that we're able to do that. So I thank you again for the opportunity to speak with you. I'll be brief since it's my first time at here. The last thing I will say is, while I don't know many of you, I do know Representative Garofalo and Representative Vogel. You know me from my years of working together, that I wouldn't be here unless this was something serious and important. Thank you.
You still on the good side of Northfield?
Still on the good side.
All right. Thank you very much. All right, next testifier. And then the next two testifiers on deck are, I believe it's Kate Nolan, and I apologize if I say this wrong, Remy. How do I say your last name, Remy? Perfect, exactly. You're on deck. So welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record.
My name is Ryan Smith. I own a small business that services the film industry. I'm a Air Force veteran, and in 2010, I went to Afghanistan and drove truck for a year. And when I came back, the Snowbate was on a roll, so I invested back into the film industry. And we're growing. We have a good thing going. I've been buying a new piece of equipment every year, trying to expand, giving people jobs. yeah, it's really important that this thing stays funded and keeps going. It's great, great job industry, great, great time. This is my business partner, Jesse Deary.
Hi.
Welcome to the committee.
Thank you, members of the committee, Mr. Chair. I just wanted to also speak to, not only is it our jobs and our livelihood, and it's just that we're not just artists, it's a business, and that we're entrepreneurs, and we've been able to contribute each year since 2013, since the Snowbite, of adding equipment, adding drivers, and like Brian Simpson, who spoke earlier, said, it's not just a temporary job. Today I was working with General Mills, and next week I work with Best Buy, and then, and when movies come in, you know, you go to the one movie, then you go to the next one, and hopefully with your support, we'll be able to keep that going, because we really like it here, and we really want to stay in Minnesota, but as business owners, you know, we'll have to go where the business is, but this is a great place. We'd love to stay here. So thank you for your support.
And Mr. Smith, thank you for your service to the country.
No
we appreciate
problem.
It. Any questions for members of the committee? Representative Hartman.
Thank you. I was just wondering what your business does.
We rent motorhomes to them to office out of. So we buy a motorhome locally and remodel it for production needs.
Just want to thank all the people who took the time to send emails to members of the committee and detail your views and give us a little bit of information. And although we don't always respond to every single email that comes from outside of our district, we heard you. And so thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for your support. Appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Our next testifiers. And then is Bob Davis here? Okay. And Kate, we got you right now, right?
Yes.
Okay. And Carol McCormick? Is Carol McCormick here? Welcome to the committee. Please state your names for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Thank you, Chairman Garofalo, members of the committee. My name is Remy Aubergenois. I am an actor and a filmmaker. I'm sorry I didn't wear my tie. I do that on TV when I play a doctor or a lawyer. I'm coming from New York. We recently relocated here, and I saw firsthand the effects of incentives on production in New York City. When we first moved to New York, there was basically law and order, and I can tell you I did any number of law and orders. And then there was a very aggressive push for incentives, not only in the state, but also in the city. Mayor Bloomberg introduced a local incentive, and we saw an explosion of production in the city. So now we went from having one or two shows being produced in New York to 26 shows being produced in a year, and the industry really thrived and grew. So I can attest, you know, I've done episodes of The Good Wife, I've done episodes of Boardwalk Empire, I've done episodes of The Sopranos, and I can tell you that those television shows were there primarily because of the tax incentives. Los Angeles saw a great deal of runaway production to Canada, New York, because California did not have incentives. They have now introduced incentives. California, you would think, wouldn't be concerned by the fact that Hollywood wasn't getting any incentives. The people upstate in California don't care how Hollywood does, but eventually they did have to introduce incentives to try to get some of that stuff back. So I can speak as a worker, but I can also speak as a producer. I'm an independent filmmaker. We came here and made a film in 2014, which Kate can speak to. But as a producer, I can tell you that this money is very mobile, okay? Film productions do go where the money will get them further down the road. And if my dollar is gonna get me 25% less far down the road in a state like this, I'm not gonna come to this state. It was a key part of our budget plan that we were gonna get money back from the state and also from the Iron Range, and we would not have been able to produce the film in this state were it not for those incentives. And so those things do go away. It's also not just about businesses here. It's about producers from out of state who are looking at where it's going to be most attractive for them to work. And then there are homegrown industries, like the gentleman who just spoke, that service those productions. So you have our relatively small film. We rented vehicles. We rented equipment. We stayed in hotels. We ate food. And we paid local crews. The local crews then go on to work in a commercial, as the gentleman from IATSE said, or they go on to work on a corporate gig. But I can bet you that Target and Best Buy, they're going to be shooting their commercials elsewhere. The advertising agency may be based here, the corporation may be based here, but they're going to go somewhere else to make their commercial. Then what you have is you have a crew base that withers. And then the big movies don't come here, and the small movies can't come here. And then that's what makes the state not open for business. So when if you say you defund the film commission, and 49 states have film commissions, that's what makes the state not open for business. So these things do have an effect.
Thank you. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Kate Nowlin. Happy to be here, Chairperson Garofalo, members. I'm a Minnesota native, but lived in New York and just recently relocated because I wanted to raise my daughter here. And my husband was game. And we relocated largely after our experience of filming an independent feature film up on the Iron Range two summers ago. We were inspired by Minnesota is a great place because of the crew that already exists here from the commercial industry and the growing film industry. But the natural resources, the locations are incredible. We brought our producers from New York to scout northern Minnesota and then the Twin Cities, and they couldn't get over the resources, the locations, and then the people. So it's a tremendous resource, and it's a very hospitable environment for film and television. We completed production in 2014. We're about to have our world premiere on our film that we're very proud of. And I am now currently in development for two new television series, one of which should be shot on the Iron Range. I have secured investment locally, assuming Snowbate stays in place. The other series will be shot in Minneapolis and St. Paul in the metro area, again, through the investment that will partner with the incentive program. As Remy said, and our experience can attest to as professional actors in New York, we went and worked wherever there was an incentive program. Last summer, I was in Pittsburgh shooting a cable television series that was slated to go to North Carolina. North Carolina got rid of their incentive program and moved to Pittsburgh, which has a healthy, Pennsylvania, thank you. It has a healthy incentive program. We are here expressing our desire to support this funding because we have seen firsthand how it can affect the local community in the state, all for good. And we hope you reconsider your decision and keep Snowbate in place and support the film board. It's a healthy and thriving industry that will only grow more. Thank you.
Thank you both very much for your testimony. We appreciate it.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, so the remaining names I have on my list here, I believe, are those from the government affairs community, lobbyists, or representatives of the government. Are there anyone here not paid to be here? All right, there's a gentleman back there with a suit on and a notebook. You want to write, just pass that around. The gentleman right there doesn't need to fill it out because he'll be first, Harry, so just have him come down. But raise your hand if you're not being paid to be here, and Mr. Kennedy will go around and get your name on that testifier list. And then we'll go from there. Welcome to the committee, sir. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
My name is Michael Hansen. I am a business owner in Virginia, Minnesota. The company is Wide Range Films. I'm also representing a associate of mine who was also mentioned earlier of Ironbound Studios in Chisholm, Minnesota. His name is Jerry Sepala. Unfortunately, he's not able to be here today. Two years ago, Wide Range Films and Ironbound Studios kind of started a separate business venture based solely on Snowbate and the IRRB rebate incentives that are offered on top. Since then, we've grown infrastructure, crew base, and quite a large resource of a large network. This year in 2016, in January, we partnered with Ironbound Studios to bring a collaborative effort to the state of Minnesota. Train of thought here.
Don't worry, Representative Mahoney does it all the time. All right. So it's very, very standard, so don't worry about it.
So let me just jump ahead here. So personal story right here. Last week, I get a phone call from a line producer out in Hollywood. Very prestigious film that's going to come here to Minnesota. One of the highest, biggest actors of all time. They were slated to do their production in Philadelphia and New York because of those film incentives. They heard about our film incentives here. The very next day, they were here in Minnesota. I scouted for 850 miles, roughly, over the course of 48 hours with these people. They wrote, while in my car, they rewrote their entire script to fit the state of Minnesota. This production is well over $1 million, and by the time they were done here, they were ecstatic. They were ready to go back and tell the rest of the world about how great Minnesota is in the film community, the rebates that we do have here. In addition to bringing the different clientele that we have, the different infrastructure that we have going on in Chisholm and in Virginia, Minnesota, we've been working with cities across southern Minnesota as well to implement a privately funded incentive on top of Snowbate as well. As you can imagine, this has brought a lot of attention to Hollywood, and a lot of people have expressed their interest. Because of their interest, Ironbound and Wide Range Films has nearly $300 million over the next 5 years in possible productions that can come here. Now, if you take that amount of money and you split that across the dollar multiplier, that there's facts and figures that everybody would kind of argue what the real value of that is. But let's just say that that dollar is $3, that's a $3 spread on that $1. That means the state of Minnesota can tax that dollar three different times. You're really not investing a lot of your money. You're actually getting your chance, yourself a chance to get your money back and make a profit off of the investment, this rebate program. And in fact, instead of trying to delete this program, you should be doubling the money of this, because what will happen there is you're going to attract network shows like HBO, Showtime, lots of other big business shows. And then also, just my closing statement here, Minnesota is a very, very well open-minded society here, with states like Georgia with passing their anti-gay bills coming up here. Whole organizations such as like Netflix are basically threatening to leave the entire state of Georgia. They got to go somewhere. Why not embrace what we have here and open our door and invite those kind of productions in? Right now, trying to close this is absolutely the wrong time, because there's a lot of stuff right on your door front that you're probably not even aware of. And I invite you to come to dinner with me, spend a day with me, and I'll show you what's exactly going on. I thank you.
Thank you very much for your testimony. We appreciate you taking the time to speak with us. Seeing no further questions, we'll go to our next testifier, Carrie Shake. And Christina, is it Pippa? Pippa? She left? Okay. Bill Coleman, you're on deck. So, welcome to the committee, sir. Please state your name for the record.
Thank you. My name is Kerry Shake. I'm an insurance agent in Minnetonka, Minnesota. Been a resident of Minnesota all my many years. And I thank you, Representative Graflow, and the committee for allowing me to speak. I'm a small player, like many in the film industry. It dawns on me as I'm listening to everybody. I'm speaking on behalf of not myself, but it comes to mind many who can't be here, who are also bit players. There's many, many in this industry that I've come to recognize. And I've benefited as they have. And previous speaker, Mike, and I've been talking, and I realize it's an expansive industry. It's a grant. You know, I appreciate if we can have this grant continue. It's a grant that keeps on giving. I sent emails to most of the committee members, and my experience with the film board has been superb. It was a recent, by coincidence, I've known Lucinda Winder for a number of years and never approached her for this sort of business. I haven't had business dealings with them. I insured several of the big productions that came here the last year, and it's enhanced my income, especially since I lost several large accounts through bankruptcies and other national companies buying Minnesota companies. This is a big industry, as you're hearing tonight, and I'm here to testify on behalf of those that can't be here, but it's helped myself, it's helped many others. One of the film productions was in Virginia, Minnesota, and I happen to know my son's in-laws come from Virginia by coincidence. And not only the direct monies that is spent in the production, there's extra spending in that city, the Cane Lake Candy Company, I'm sure down the street, the hotel that was mentioned. I understand there's a cafe in the town, in the Iron Range. They all benefited, but never were accounted for. You've heard the number, $12 million has produced $53 million to this date. You've seen those numbers, you've heard some mention of it. This is real, those are direct dollars, but I encourage you to think about the indirect dollars that also have been spent that aren't accounted for. And this is all part of it. This is a great industry, and I'm realizing we've sown the seeds, we've got the momentum going. We're one of the Minnesota teams that are really ready to pay off. We've had difficulty with some of our sports teams, as fortunately you all know. Don Zemi, the film industry is ready to hit some home runs. And to pull the rug out right now would be unconscionable. There's many, many more benefits to for many players benefit. The good it is beyond them, it's the financial end of it, and then you've heard others, and I've heard and seen evidence, those that have come here are enamored. They're attracted by the snow bait, the little dollar is an important factor, but once they're here, as I tell my clients in southern states, y'all come, you hear? And it's a lovely place to come to, and they're finding that out, and they're passing the word on to others. I conclude my remarks with a little comment I made in my email. I'm a graduate of the business school at the University of Minnesota in the 60s. My insurance professor, C. Arthur Williams, he said, the risk manager's axiom is never risk a lot for a little. And it dawns on me that you're risking a small, relatively small funding grant that'll bring back huge dollars. And of course, my Econ 101 professor said, it's called the power of money, where a dollar spent is respent 3 to 5 times. And each time it's respent, we'll pay taxes. And I submit that a good share of this, I can't account for it exactly, but it wouldn't surprise me a bit that the $10 million that's granted will come back manyfold in the short run and the long run. Thank you very much for letting me speak.
Mr. Shaikh, thank you very much for your testimony. One moment. Representative Mensa has a question. Go ahead, Mr. Mensa.
You know, Mr. Chair, I was going to save this for the end, but since we're getting the public here who on this issue, I think I'd like to share my comment with. It's unfortunate that we're in a state right now with a $900 million surplus, and we're talking about cutting a program like this. All the other testimony from today, different cuts. This is exactly what people are sick of us as politicians for, is you're afraid to raise a target. Your leadership's afraid to have swing district members vote on bills that put you in a position where you're spending money, investing. And it's absolutely ridiculous that we're down here today debating a couple million dollars that we're hearing testimony from not only some local businesses, but from some heavy hitters in the industry who understand how it works. And it can copy and paste right down the bill, literally right down the bill. And the fact that we're coming back into committee tonight to argue about a target that's substantially lower than it should be is ridiculous. And Minnesota deserves better. And I'd like to apologize to the room for having you even come down here to have this conversation, because we should just be funding things that make sense and not fighting over the politics and the ridiculousness of the partisanship that we put ourselves into the position. It's why Trump's popular. It's why Bernie Sanders is popular, because people are sick of us. So.
I'm not sick of you, but I want to appreciate your reconsideration.
Thank you very much, Mr. Shaikh. Thank you. Any other members' questions?
Touché.
Thank you. Mr. Coleman, please introduce yourself for the committee.
Thank you, Chairman Baker and members of the committee. My name is Bill Coleman, and I've worked on broadband-focused economic development for more than 15 years here in Minnesota. Over the time, I've been involved in some capacity with almost every Minnesota broadband project. Today I'm here representing my own views. I have three key points, and first is a state broadband goal. Please do not accept the 25.3 megabit as a state broadband goal. Know that 25.3 is the FCC's minimum definition of what broadband is today. That standard has increased 30-fold since 2008. And so if you go forward 8 years, we'd be at about 750 megabits of a comparable speed of today, assuming that technology doesn't accelerate, which it has been. Why would we tie our Minnesota 2022 goal to a minimum and dynamic federal standard? I would ask you to recognize a 3 meg upload speed is a 40 to 66% decrease in our existing 2010 goal of the 5 to 10 megabit per second. I think this would be an embarrassment for Minnesota to decrease our speed goal with only a minimal speed increase on the upload or on the download speed. You know, since that 2010, you know, our speed goal that was set by the original task force and the legislature, the speed goal was about half the market speed, you know, what was advertised in the Twin Cities by Comcast, 20 or 40 to 50 megabits. Now, you know, it's gigabit level services available, and we're increasing, proposing to increase our speed by 5 megabits over a 6-year period. The task force would also recommended 100 megabit by 20 megabit by 2026 is what I prefer. Margaret Anderson Kelleher now calls this an aspirational goal. You should know that at present, using state funds to pursue the minimum goal will not have a significant ability on our ability to get to the 100 megabit goal. When we do this 25-3, that's essentially a rural DSL solution. And there's just not much opportunity to go from that 25 to 100, and especially in 4 years. Essentially, that's like saying, well, I'm going to lose 3 pounds by Thanksgiving and then another 30 between Thanksgiving and Christmas. Mm-hmm. There's just no connection there. I would also like to offer an alternative goal, which would be to simply drop the low-end speed references of our current goal and set our state goal then as 20 down and 10 up. We should remember that upload speed enables economic development and producers, like our film people here, when they go out to the Iron Range, they're going to need to have 100 megabit connections to upload gigabits of data where it might be processed elsewhere. That's another big part of our mix, whether you're a physician, an architect, any kind of producer. The second point I'd make is the incumbent right of first refusal. You know, due to the nature as public traded companies, our large incumbent providers have caused a broadband crisis in rural Minnesota through their own investment decisions. I don't blame them for making those decisions about where to make more money, but it's their decisions that have left rural Minnesota without broadband. Even with the improved networks built to today's FCC broadband minimum definitions, the future lack of investment by these incumbents would be an ongoing deterrent to the economic competitiveness of these rural areas. On the other hand, if these providers would be required to build to the new state goal of 100 megabits within 2 years, I could support that provision. And then finally, two additional points on this is that this bill does not offer any proposed remedy for the community or prospective competitor provider if an incumbent provider fails to build within that 2-year period of which they supposedly would commit to. Rural communities have been promised upgrades repeatedly through the last decade with little to show for it, and I fear that would continue. I also have concerns about the allowance of CAF 2 as provider match, possibly as the sole source of match. If a project is going to be 100% government funded, possibly including a combination of federal, state, and local funds as well, these networks should be open access, available to any telecommunications provider to provide service. And the open access model is a technically possible model to do. And if the government's going to pay for it all, why should somebody else but the government possibly own it? And then on economic development, broadband's now a key determinant of economic development and quality of life. For business, a simple yes or no answer over 25-3 availability is not enough. Businesses want multiple providers, redundant routes, installed fiber optics to the development site, ready for shovel-ready development. Communities should be able to partner with providers to ensure that this infrastructure is in place in advance to ensure their economic competitiveness. I do support the increased match requirements for the economic development projects. With that, I'd say thank you very much for your consideration.
Thank you, Mr. Coleman, for testifying today. Any questions from members? Seeing none, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next up is Stephanie Tofty, please. If you could come down, and next on deck is Michael Arnold. Yeah. He'll be in the wings. Welcome, Ms. Tofty. If you could introduce yourself for the record and go ahead with your testimony. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. My name is Stephanie Tofty, and I am a cinematographer from Minneapolis. I am here representing myself to testify against provisions which eliminate fiscal year 2017 operating budgets for both the Minnesota Film and TV Board and the Upper Minnesota Film Office, and which eliminate Snowbate funding and repeal Minnesota Statute 116U.26. Film production jobs are 21st century jobs. It's a hybrid industry with room for a wide variety of skill sets with an infinite number of paths to success. Folks coming from trades and academia are both at home on set. Film production is for anyone who shows up each day willing to learn as they go, because it's about project-driven work conducted by a team of hardworking individuals. If you've ever been on set, you know that we work harder than anyone, and we have more endurance than anyone, and we're happy to do the work. We arrive early and have coffee and breakfast together. We break for lunch and eat together. We connect, we become family. Each film set becomes Minnesota's best workplace every year, but nobody gets to seems to get the memo. Our work keeps us healthy because it's hands-on and we move throughout the day. Our work keeps us mentally healthy because each day on set brings new and exciting problems to solve. Our work product is for everyone, and we work hard to create something that has lasting value. 13 years ago, long before I allowed myself to pursue a career in filmmaking, I was just starting out as an urban planner with the city of Raleigh, North Carolina. We were in the early planning stages for light rail and transit-oriented development, and we would often point to Atlanta as an example of what not to do when it came to urban sprawl and transportation planning. Atlanta grew before we did, and we were able to learn from their mistakes and serve as responsible stewards of urban planning and policy. Now, I'm just starting out as a freelance cinematographer, and I find myself and my filmmaking peers looking to Atlanta as an example of what not to do, of what to do in terms of growing a film incentive program, while we look to North Carolina as an example of how not to govern. I won't read the whole thing because I have emailed you my remarks, but overall, I want to say that look at what North Carolina has done to the film program and where the jobs went in the wake of the tax incentive being eliminated there or reduced greatly. Their loss was Georgia's gain. And if we lose our tax incentive program in Minnesota, we lose our jobs, we lose the work. And like I said, individuals coming from a trades background or academia, we're both at home on set. They're good jobs, and without a consistent and competitive funding level, we can't compete. So I appreciate your time, and I'll take any questions if there are any.
Thank you, Ms. Tofty. Members have any questions? Great job. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
Michael Arnold, please. Welcome to the table, and would you please introduce yourself for the record?
Michael Arnold, Mr. Chair and Committee.
Oh,
Mr. Chair, my name's Edward Reynoso. I'm the political director for the Teamsters. I'm going to kind of set it up at the beginning and hand it off to Mr. Arnold, if
so
that's okay.
Running we're together. I'm here. Okay, good. Yes. I just want to make sure we get the right person here. So, all right, thank you, Mr. Arnold. And I'm sorry, would you say your name again, please?
Edward Reynoso.
Welcome. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. First of all, I mean, if it's indicative of how bad this provision is in this bill, the Snowbate, eliminating the Snowbate program, I can't ever remember in my career as a Teamster coming to testify on the same issue on the same position with anybody from the chamber. So if that's indicative of how bad this would be for Minnesota, I don't know what would. As the political director of the Teamsters, we represent an excess of 62,000 active and retired members in the state of Minnesota, many which are employed in the Minnesota film industry. We have Teamsters that work in the movie production, documentaries, TV series, and some commercials. There's no question in our mind that if the Snowbate program is eliminated, that funding is not there, we are going to lose thousands of jobs, and we are going to lose millions of dollars of revenue. I know the question came up earlier about closed for business. I could tell you exactly what closed for business in the TV and motion picture industry looks like. Gran Torino was a movie that was based and thought of by a St. Paulite, somebody that envisioned the movie in our community, yet was filmed in Michigan because we didn't have the funding for a Snowbate program here. That's what closed business looks like. New in Town, another movie based in the concept was in New Ulm, Minnesota. Yep, because we didn't have the funding, it was filmed in Canada. That's what closed for business looks like. And that's what's gonna happen if we lose this Snowbate money. Precisely gonna happen. You know, I can sit here as a lobbyist and as a political director and tell you what we believe is going to happen and how it's going to negatively impact this business, this industry. But there's probably nobody better than one of our members that actually works in the industry himself, that understands the impact, understands the business, and what it looked like before Snowbate and what it looks like after Snowbate. And he can tell you precisely what's gonna happen if Snowbate goes away. So with that, if Mr. Arnold.
Thank you very much. Mr. Arnold, please, with your testimony. Say your full name again, please.
Mike Arnold, and I'm a teamster, I'm a captain and a coordinator. So I know how the money gets spent on movies and how much it makes for our state. And if we lose this, it's gonna hurt a lot of people in Minnesota. I mean, I won't be able to keep my house. That's how bad it would be. I mean, I rely on movies and commercials and little documentaries to make my living. Brian Smith, he has two motorhomes, and he has a two-room bathroom, and he could lose that, all that. And we have other trucks in town, too, also, that people just recently bought, and we lose all that. And I worked on a Converley movie in 2008, and just my department alone, picture cars, I spent $200,000, just me alone. And I helped out lots of people with different problems with money because they made money off the cars I rented from them. So it's really disheartening that you guys would want to get rid of the Snowbate. And we do need more than the $10 million in the future to really be competitive. I mean, $20 million would be great because we do have a thing called Stillwater that wants to film in Stillwater. It'd be fantastic. And the director did Grumpy Old Men, and he loves it here, and he wants to come back. So it'd be nice if you guys could change your mind and give our Snowbate back. And I'll let that go with that. I could talk forever.
Mr. Arnold, thank you very much. Members, any questions for either testifier?
Mr. General? Chair, if I just may, just one last
thing.
You know, we as Minnesotans, we take a lot of pride in our state. And homegrown products such as the Coen Brothers, such as New Ulm, new in town, such as Stillwater. We want to be able to expand beyond that, bring a series to Minnesota that would create thousands upon thousands of jobs and millions in revenue. We can't do that without a Snowbate program. There's no question. So I urge you to reconsider. We ask that you refund the Snowbate program. We're asking for the $10 million. I'd love to ask for more, but we'll settle for the 10 right now.
I even give 1% of my income back to the state.
Mr. Arnold, all right.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Gentlemen, thank you very much for your testimony. Thank you.